Good morning, everybody. Happy Sunday. Who's glad to be in the house of the Lord today? God is good. Amen. Church, this morning I invite you to get to your feet with us. And just like every Sunday, I want to invite you to help me to fill the house of the Lord with prayer today. God, this morning I want to start off by saying thank you, Lord, for another day of life, God. Thank you for life, Lord. Thank you for your goodness, God. Thank you for your love. God, this morning we stand here, Lord, asking that you just reveal yourself in this place, God. Reveal yourself in our lives. Whatever you have prepared for us, God, may it just strengthen us and keep us going in the path that you have set out for us. God, this morning we ask for any of those, God, who need peace of mind, Lord, for those who need peace in their lives, God, for those who need their heart strengthened, God. We ask that you just start touching their lives, Lord. Healing in the body, God. May those joints start feeling better, God. May those lungs breathe fresh air. Heavenly Father, you have been so good to us. And this morning we come to worship you. We worship you, God. In the battle, we worship you. Heavenly Father, you are the one who gives us strength, and we recognize that this morning. Receive our hearts' worship, God, to you. We come to praise you, Lord. Not just because of what you've done, God, but because of who you are. We don't deserve any of the love, we don't deserve any of it, God, yet you give it to us. So this morning, we reach out to you, God. In our brokenness, in our hurt, in our pain, in the joy, God, in your goodness, we reach out. We pray this in your most holy and precious name. Amen. So I wanted to share with you guys, yesterday I had a day. Woke up super early because I had to be at work at 5:30 in the morning. And I'm like, oh Lord, thank you for today. And the day went on and, you know, life was happening. And I got invited to dinner. It was one of those dinners where I just needed some fellowship, you know. You ever have one of those where you just sit with genuine people, thank God for them, you know, and we started talking, you know, we get together every so often, we started talking, and I was just reminded that my route, I heard it once before, was when you look for God, when you search him, when you seek him, you're going to notice that he's been there the whole time. Amen. Amen. And we're talking about, you know, things that have been going on, our visions, our goals, you know, how are you seeking God? How are you realizing, you know, how are you taking the time to spend with God? Like, what are you doing? You know, and I had a moment and I'm like, I find him in the most odd places, and that's the beautiful thing. You know, and the grumpy old lady who was yelling at everybody, but at me was super nice, you know? And the cute little five-year-old who's like, God bless you, man. Have a beautiful day. You know, God is in all places, and we just have to search for him. Amen. And this morning, I genuinely encourage you. You know, our conversation was, he just wants us to worship him. You know, so this morning, as we get together, as we praise, as we worship, find your moment with God today. He's with us. Amen.
You are.
today. God, you have been so good to us. And this morning we come prepared to worship you, God. That is our purpose, Lord. May we intently worship you this morning, God. Oh, God, you have been so good. Father, it is your name that breaks chains, God. In your name we have the victory. And this morning we declare, God, that in the trial, God, in the struggle, we focus on you. God, in blind faith, we believe that because of you, we will be victorious, God. God, surround us. Fill this place. We believe that you are with us. You are our Savior, and this morning we come to praise and worship your name.
My Jesus, my Savior, Lord.
hold on to your goodness, God. May we find it in every step we take, every turn we make, God. May we just recognize that you're there. Heavenly Father, you are so good to us. May we never let that go. You cover us, you protect us, you love us, you guide us. What more can we want? God, this morning we come to praise you, we come to worship you. God, take my heart and mold it to be pleasing to you. We're not perfect. God, we have troubles, but this is where we worship you. We worship you, God, in our battles. God, receive this praise, God. Receive this worship that we bring to you this morning. We love you, God.
to use a pastor's mic. Yes.
Because I talk with my hands, so.
You're a Martinez.
Yeah. All right, good morning, everybody. How are y'all doing today?
Good morning.
Good. All right, before we get started, I want to go ahead and do a moment of silence, not only for Memorial Day as we honor those who have fallen for our country, but also because of the events that have happened this week. So if you can just bow your heads for a couple of moments as we pay our respects. Thank you guys for sharing that with me. So, I guess the reason I say that and I do that is because it's been a week. I think we can all agree it's been a lot, right? So for those of you who don't know me, I work in the juvenile justice field. I work with the juveniles and their families, and I started about 4 years ago in the detention center out in San Antonio, and have kind of worked into the different sectors of probation, and now back here with the state here in El Paso. And I say that because a lot of what I talk about today comes from that. And so first off, I want to share something with you. And that's that on August the 25th of 2021, I took this Bible and I put my hand on it. And I got sworn in to protect these families, to help serve them, to meet their needs in whatever way that I can. And it's important to me because this Bible was given to my dad, who then gave it to me, by my grandfather. And he was the rock, him and my grandma, I'm sure she's probably watching, him and my grandma, they were the rock, they were the foundation of our faith. So this Bible, and unfortunately I'm not going to use it today since it's in Spanish, that was important to me because that showed me that everything that I do in this career, everything that I do in this life, needs to be based on God. So, as I said, it's been a week. Monday morning, I woke up to a phone call at 7 o'clock in the morning from one of my families. And it was a parent, she was hysterical, talking about how her child had attempted to harm himself by an overdose. And I thought, oh my God, it's 7 a.m. and you woke up to that. Like, what are we doing? What's going on with this world? And as the day progressed, things got harder because, of course, there's paperwork and then there's checking on the family, checking on the kid, making sure he's okay. And then, the week gets longer because then we hear that there is this shooting that happens in Uvalde. And I don't know about you guys, but for me, all I could sit and think was, what is happening in this world? Like, what is going on? I mean, you're overwhelmed with sadness, but disbelief, and then you're also feeling like there's just so much happening that you just don't know what to do anymore. And of course, as Christians, we want to say, oh yeah, we trust God. God is going to take care of us, and He does. But sometimes it's harder for us, I think, to really, truly feel that. Because when tragedy comes, when tragedy strikes, what do? Do we really run to Him? Or where do we go? So, in every situation we face, we have to have a foundation, right? But I want to talk about today, what happens in the midst of tragedy. Do we really seek out God the way we should? Or what is it that we're doing? And how does that affect our families? So this morning, before we get started, I want you to just kind of reflect and think to yourself, where is my foundation? Where do I run? Or who do I run to? If y'all can turn to your Bibles in Psalm 46, verse 1. And there, the Lord tells us that God is our refuge and strength, an ever-present help in trouble. We sang so many things this morning that presented that God is our strength, God is our tower, God is where we run, right? And as He should be. And sometimes you might be thinking again, in tragedy, Neely, but you don't understand. This is the fourth or fifth time my son has been arrested. You don't understand what I'm going through. Or you don't know my daughter. She just overdosed. And I don't know what to do. Yes, of course, I know I have to believe in God. But how? How can I trust in God when this happens? And the reason you can trust in God is because he tells us he is our refuge and our strength. And it specifically says, an ever-present help in trouble. I can't think of any times more than that that would be trouble, because it is, right? It's troubling to our hearts, it's troubling to our spirits, it's troubling physically, emotionally, mentally, everything. But he is our refuge and our strength. Those are the times that we need to go first to God. And now I'm gonna say this, I am a huge advocate in counseling and talking to your pastors and getting help. But I also am an advocate in saying that you need to seek out God. When tragedy happens, you have to go to God. You know, when everything happened in Uvalde, our families go pretty far back with some of the churches out there, one of the churches in particular. And the first thing that they did when that tragedy happened was he opened the doors, that Pastor Ruiz opened the doors for people, not just his congregation, but for the entire community to come in and to pray. Why? Because in times of sorrow, because in times of tragedy, we have to fall back on our strong tower, which is God. Amen. We have to lean into him, and we cannot let what's going on around us affect how much we rely on God, because the one thing we all know is he's not going anywhere. Amen. You know, this is what we've always known. He's the same God yesterday, today, and forever. So why wouldn't we lean into him? He is what we need to do, right? And when you do that, when you go in there and you talk to God and you tell him everything, that's you surrendering to him. That's saying, you know what, God, I don't understand. Because everything that happened this week, I don't understand what happened. I don't understand why somebody decided to go and do what they did. I don't understand why this person tried to hurt themselves. I don't understand why so-and-so did this and they're now in trouble. But what I do understand is that you know God. That even though we don't know, God knows. Amen. And he is the only one who is going to be able to guide you and get you through this. So when you surrender to God, you enable him to move. Because so many times we want to move. We want to say, well, let me do this, let me do that. But no. Just take your hand out of the cookie jar for a minute. Let him do it. Because what happens whenever you try and hurt me, things get messed up. Things don't work. But in order to move forward, and sometimes it's just to ask for wisdom. In order to get that wisdom, you have to surrender to God. Because if you're sitting there and you're fighting and saying, well, no, God, but I know this happened, but you know this, but I know this. How are you going to let yourself have the wisdom to move forward, right? So the first thing you've got to do is you've got to surrender. You've got to lay it down at your feet, at his feet. And just tell him, God, I don't know why. I don't understand. This is how I feel. Pour your heart out to him and tell him, hey, here you go, God. And let him make the moves. And so you might, you know, be wondering what it has to do with your family Sunday, because this is family Sunday. And to me, it's because I see families here and I work with families. And it's because God needs to be the foundation of your family. He needs to be your strong tower. Your kids need to know that in good times, of course, and especially in bad times, that God is your refuge. God is your strength. He is your strong tower. Because I guarantee you that if you don't teach them that he is what you run to, they will run to something else. Amen. And that is the thing we try and prevent, the thing we try and avoid, because nobody wants to see their family, their loved one, or somebody run away from God, run away and do things to hurt them, to mess things up for themselves, when they could have just told them, hey, it's God. He is the answer. So at the core of the foundation, you have to have God, right? And I think it's great, you know, we have to have our, we have to have our coping methods. Some people, they're stressed out, they go to the gym, they'll run. That's some people, not all people. they run or they'll go, they'll work out. Some people just want to sit down and, hey, you know what? So-and-so, can I have a cup of coffee with you? Can I just talk? Because I just need to get this off my chest. Some people, they like to take naps. I mean, we see in the Bible, you know, God gave a nap and food to one of our men in the Bible, and there you go. He was okay the next day, right? So there are so many different ways that we can cope. But again, at the foundation, it needs to be God. So how is it that you teach people, or how is it that you teach your kids that God is the foundation, well, first of all, you have to teach them to pray. And I know, you know, we teach our kids, you know, I don't know if you guys know this or if you grew up with the prayer, you know, God is great, God is good, let us thank you for, I know the prayer like the back of my hand. you know, you pray for your food, you pray for safe travels, you pray for all of these, you know, different things that we deal with in daily life. But the one thing that I urge you to teach them to pray for is to pray when their hearts are heavy. Because sometimes kids don't quite understand what it means to have a heavy heart. They just know they don't feel good. Or sometimes, you know, they don't understand, you know, I don't know what's happening, but I don't know what to do. And they think, you know, we'll just brush it off. The next thing you know, we're bottling up emotions and all sorts of stuff is happening with these kids. But I urge you to teach them to pray when their hearts are heavy. If they tell you, hey, I'm not feeling good, you know, my heart hurts, I'm sad, you know, so-and-so made me feel bad, pray. And I know that it might sound like these trivial little things, but when we teach them as kids and when we teach them when they're younger to pray in these times where they're feeling heavy, then that shows them and that reminds them in the future, hey, I remember when I was a kid and I felt sad, my grandma told me, hey, let's pray. Just like Jacob said last week, I was hurt and everything, and I said, we called my grandma because my grandma said, just pray. And things change because prayer changes things. There is a reason that Jesus taught the disciples how to pray. Matthew, the Lord's Prayer, it's word for word written in there how to pray. You know, our Father who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. You know, prayers that we most of us recite, we know them. And that's how Jesus taught them to pray. So we need to teach our kids how to pray. Mind you, if I say my kids, I'm talking about all my kiddos. So just so you know, I have a lot of them. But, and again, it goes back to like Uvalde. What's the first thing he did? He opened the doors for people to pray. Their hearts were heavy. Many of our hearts were heavy too in that situation. Not only at that, but then the week before, the shooting at a church. A week before that, a shooting in a grocery store. You know, all of these different things that are happening in this world, we have to teach our kids. When you feel that way, pray. When you're hurting, pray. Because that is the, you know, basis of starting a relationship with God, is knowing how to communicate with him, knowing how to tell him how you're feeling, how to just pour it out. And the beauty of it is that even though God knows how we feel, because he knows everything, right? Amen. He can tell you, like, you know, I could be feeling so, you know, frustrated and upset right now. And God knows, but he wants to hear it anyway. Because what does communication do? Communication builds relationships. Amen. And that's what he wants, to build a relationship, not only with you, but with your kids, with your, you know, extended family, with your little family unit you've got going on. He wants to build a relationship. So the next thing that I have to say is that if you want to teach your kids to have God as a refuge, to have God as a foundation, it's to use the Bible. This book right here is your instruction manual. And of course, you know, there are some things that I guess people might say, well, that's not in there. Well, really, it kind of is. There are things in here that can tell you how to handle situations. I can tell you the godly way to handle anger, the godly way to be joyful, even how to praise, how to worship, and even more important, how to have a relationship. So in Psalm 119:105, the Bible says that your word is a lamp unto my feet and a light for my path. I want you to think about something for a minute. You have your cell phones, right? Everybody has a cell phone here? You have them? Okay. So when you turn on your flashlight, how far does it give you? Does it give you like you can see way, way ahead of you, or doesn't, right? Just gives you maybe a little bit right there. So think about how that translates over to the Bible. It doesn't necessarily tell us everything we're going to deal with. We don't know. We may not know what's 6 steps ahead of us. But right here in front of our feet, we have the lamp, the light, that's going to show us where to go next. And that's what the Word does. That's what the Bible does for your kids. It does for your family. Because even when we don't know what's going to happen, because let's be real, these are uncertain times. We don't know what's going to happen next. But at least we have something that's going to guide us. And that's going to show us what steps to take. Hey, take 2 steps forward. Stop for a little bit. Okay, another 3 steps. because it's a light that shows you just what you need to see to keep moving forward. And those are things that our kids need to know. Because again, this is an uncertain time. And, you know, most of us I know are a little bit, I don't want to say we don't follow direction, but we're human, right? So we have our moments when we don't always follow instructions. But if we have an instruction manual like this in front of us, then we got to be the example to these kids. Amen. We have to follow it. We've got to be the ones showing them, hey, I know you're scared. I know that right now things don't seem okay, but this right here and God right there is what's going to help us to move forward. And that's what we need to teach them. That's how we need to instruct them. So let me ask you all this. And you, I mean, if you answer me, it's okay. But do you know where the term Christian came from? Or what it was from? If you don't, it's okay. I barely found this out maybe like a year ago. Of course, we know it means that that's somebody who follows Christ, right? But in biblical times, the word Christian was used to actually identify people because they were so much like Christ, because they followed him, they were identified as a Christian. So I'm going to tell you a little story. This was one of my kids, and we had a very good rapport. You know, this is when I worked in the detention facility. We had a really good rapport with this kid, but there was one day in particular where he was just testing my patience a lot. I mean, you know, and then it happens with their kids. And it was one of those things where every maybe 30, 45 minutes or so throughout an 8-hour shift, I was getting a call, Martinez, can you come over to this unit? We have so-and-so need to talk to you. So there I'd go. Mind you, it's San Antonio, it's summertime, it's hot, it is hot over there, and it's the humidity, like the wet heat is just gross, it's horrible. So to walk all the way from the front of the building, all the way to the back to go see this kid. And I had to keep doing that because he kept acting up. He was acting up and they knew that we had a good rapport. I was trying my best to stop from sending him to our security unit. You know, just because he's just being a kid, right? And eventually, I think it was maybe about the fourth or fifth time I made that walk over there. I told him, I was like, look, I said, I'm gonna need you to get up and come with me. Because if you don't get up and come with me, then we're gonna have some problems. And he says, Ms. Martinez, I thought you were a Christian. And I told him, I said, I am, but I'm from the south side of the kingdom. And he looks at me and we laugh and we both laugh. And then, you know, he walks with me or whatever. But then that got me thinking. This kid who, from what I know, didn't know God, didn't know anything about Jesus, still knew what it was like to be Christ-like. And he knew that in my impatience and in my frustration with him and everything that was going on, he knew that that was out of character, that that was not something that Christians do. Of course, you know, we get frustrated, we're human, but all that to say, kids are watching. So the most important thing you can do as a parent, as an aunt, an uncle, a cousin, somebody who these kids look up to, is to show them. Show them how God is your refuge. Show them how he is your tower. You know, I mean, there's even a song, I think, it talks about, it's a country song, and the guy says, and then my 4-year-old said a 4-letter word, and it started with this, and I was concerned, and the kid says, well, it's because I've been watching you. And these kids, they learn everything. They follow everything. Even teenagers, they start to see how you cope with things. They start to see how you deal with anger, how you deal with frustration, with sadness, and they're gonna learn it. That's just how it is. I know people say that little kids are, you know, they soak everything up like a sponge, but so do teenagers. They do. And sometimes they go opposite, you know, because they want to, but sometimes they don't. And if we're not doing what we need to do as role models, as parents, as you know, those people in their lives, then what are we teaching them? So we have to make sure that we teach them what the true foundation is, and the true foundation, the answer, as always, is God. He's the one. So when, you know, something bad happens, I referred to earlier to somebody getting arrested, like let's say, you know, oh, your dad got arrested. How are you going to help this kid out? How are you going to handle it? Well, how you handle it is how they're going to handle it. Simple as that. Then I say that because it's important It's important to show them, okay, yes, this is tragedy. Yes, we're in a hard time, but this is what we do. We're going to go before God and we're going to pray. The first thing we're going to do is we're going to get on our knees right here as a family. We're going to pray and we're going to give it to God. We're going to surrender and we're going to ask Him to just tell us what to do next. And we're going to look in the Bible and we're going to see, okay, well, Proverbs says this, Psalm says this. You know, look and see what it is that the Bible says to speak to us. And we're going to move forward. And what you do there in those moments, it may not seem like it at the time, but I guarantee that's something that's going to stick in their heads. Because they will always remember, always, always, always remember seeing you do that. That in the time of tragedy, this is what happened and this is what you did. And that's how they need to react. Right now, I want to talk about Daniel. You know, he had three friends, right? And they were Hananiah, Mishael, and Azariah. And, of course, the Bible tells us that King Nebuchadnezzar changed their names. Those were their Hebrew names. He changed them to Shadrach, Meshach, and Abednego. So what happened to Daniel and these three boys is they, you know, just a brief overview, they were taken from their tribe. Their tribe, you know, was attacked, they were taken, and they were held captive. But the king saw favor with Daniel, so he kind of saw favor with his friends too. Until the day that he built this huge statue to honor himself, and he made it a law of the land that everybody had to bow down to that statue. And these three Hebrew boys, whose God is the God of Abraham, Isaac, and Jacob, who's our God, these three Hebrew boys said, no, we're not going to bow down to it. And they gave him a choice. I'm going to tell you one more time. Bow down to it. And they said no. So what happens next? They take him. He says, throw him in the furnace. And the Bible says that the furnace was so hot that even the person opening the door caught fire and died. So that in itself tells you just how hot that furnace was, how death was staring them in the face. And what happens? They get thrown in. And then later they look and the guards say, well, didn't we throw three people in there? Well, there's another guy in there. There's four. There's four people in there. All that to say God was with them and he spared them. And why? Because they are his children. Because he honored them and he didn't fall, or they didn't fall. They didn't fall into what the king wanted him to do. They didn't fall into what this world is calling our kids to do. They didn't fall into the rest of that, but they stayed on that path. What path? The path that they were brought up in. The path that their families, that their tribe, that everybody taught and instilled in them for years, because that was the path that they were shown, and they kept to it because they know God is faithful, because they know that he's the answer, because they know he's never going to leave them. The same way that our God will never leave any single person in this room. He will never leave us, our church. He will never leave us because he knows who we are. He knows every single hair on our heads.
Amen.
He knows your innermost being, and he still loves you anyway. And he won't leave us. And our kids, they need to know that. That's what they need to know. They need to know that through all of that, God will be with them. Through all of everything that goes on in their lives, that God is going to be there. That they simply just have to reach out and say, hey, I'm here. Because he hasn't gone anywhere. Even in this crazy world of everything that's been going on, he hasn't gone anywhere. Now, sometimes it might be hard to see that. It might feel like it's hard. But he's there. He's in the fire. He's in the fire just like we were. Just like we have been at times. And like we will be. Because, I mean, let's face it, life is hard. Jacob said last week, life is hard. And then even more so when things happen in this world that we don't understand, sometimes they happen to us. We can't say that they're never going to happen. Like, oh, no, it's not going to happen to me. Because you know what? It might. I'm not going to say it is, but it might. And what are we going to do when that happens? We've got to reach out for God. I mean, if we don't reach out for God, what are we doing? And the greatest, the absolute greatest thing you can do, if you love your kids, man, if you love your family, you love your kids, the greatest thing you can do is show them who God is. You can teach them the Bible, you can teach them how to pray, but you have to show them. You have to show them who he is. You gotta give them that. That is the greatest, most single, amazing act of love you could do for these kids, is teach them that. Teach them to make God their foundation. Teach them to have Him be the one that they run to. Because again, even little kids' hearts get heavy. Everybody has it at once or another. Everybody feels like that. We've all had moments where we're discouraged, where we're defeated, where we're depressed, where things are just not working. We all have those times. And we all have our own forms of tragedies. But our kids need to know that when they're in those situations, the only one to turn to is God. That He is the one who is going to work with them. He is the one who is going to comfort them. We sang it today. Lord is my peace. You're my strength. You're my strong tower. You're my refuge. How many times have we seen that today? And I know we're not just doing praise and worship karaoke. I know we're not, because we mean it, right? We sing it because He is. Because the Bible says He is. But even more so because I believe that you in here felt at one time or another that that's who He is in your life. If you didn't, you might not even be sitting here, right?
Amen.
So, you know, like I mentioned before, communication is what harbors a relationship.
Amen.
Praying, harboring a relationship with God. But that works. That's exactly what you got to do with your kids. Talk to them. Communicate with them. Tell them you love them and edify them. You know, as an officer, I can tell you that I have sat in too many cells with these kids telling me, but Martinez, my family doesn't want me. Martinez, my mom, she hates me. Or, well, if she didn't hate me, why would she do this? Or, you know, feeling like they're unloved, feeling like they're not wanted. And in the 4 years that I've been in this field, I can tell you that I've lost count of how many times I've had to run into a cell to stop a kid from hurting himself. Because they just feel so desperate. Because they have nowhere to turn. Because they feel like there is nobody in this world who cares or wants them. I can't even tell you how many times, and I could get gruesome on that, I'm not going to. But I will tell you this, it's ugly. And it's sad because it breaks your heart to see that there are people hurting like that in this world. There are so many people in this world hurting like that. And again, in the 4 years that I've been in this field, I can tell you 11 kids that I know personally who have lost their lives to the streets, all under the ages of 18, anywhere between 14 and 18, including, and I didn't know him, but now, you know, recently we had another kid who was murdered by 3 other kids, all of them 18 or under. And that right there should show you that our world needs God, that our kids need Jesus, that our kids need to know who to run to. So as a family, you know, as parents, as these role models, we have to show them. I say this in a, not, I can't say it in a nice way, but I say this in a respectful way, and I'm tired of seeing these kids deal with this. I'm tired of it. And I know that it's going to happen. It's inevitable. But it can stop. And it can start with you. Because you teach your kids, and then they teach their kids, and they teach their kids. And we stop with these, you know, generational hurts and curses and all of that, and we begin filling our families with life by showing them who God is, by showing them that He is where we go, by showing them that drugs is not the answer, alcohol is not the answer, your friends are not the answer, hurting people is not the answer. God is the answer. God is the answer now. He was the answer yesterday, and He will always be the answer, because that is who He is. So right now I want to just go ahead and invite y'all to stand. This morning, you know, your families may be here. They may be in the back working with the little kids. They can, like, can we bring them in?
They're going to bring them in, yeah.
Oh, they're going to bring them? Yeah. Okay, all right. You know, wherever they're at today, I want you to pray for them. And I'm going to go ahead and open up the altars here in a minute to bring your families down. Bring, you know, if you want to come up here as a representative, whatever you want to do. But because right now is a critical time. This is a critical time in all of our lives, but even more so in the lives of our kids, the lives of our families. And I want you all to take these moments, one, to talk to God and tell him how you feel, tell him your family situation, lift up your family, surrender your family to him. And I know that sometimes it's not easy, especially being a Christian, it's hard sometimes, you know, when the whole world is coming at you from different angles, telling you this is right, this is right, this is right. But we know that we just have to focus on what's ahead. And what's ahead is the future of our families, the future of our children, our generations. So today I want to, like I said, open up the altars, and I want to encourage you to take this time, talk to your kids, tell them you're proud of them. This is the moment to say I love you. This is the moment to say how proud you are, to apologize if you have to. But this is the moment where you take your families and you rebuild your lives on the foundation of God as your refuge. Cherish the times that you have with them and submit them to God.
Stop your will for just a moment. Stop your will for just a moment. And listen to the heartbeat of your heart. To the hurt they're going through, issues they're dealing with. Well, really nailed it. It's very basic, very fundamental. We don't need to go back there. Communication, prayer, the Word of God. And it's not enough to have a Bible. It's not enough to read it, you have to live it also. The Word of God comes alive in the hearts of our kids. And then when we're no longer around to lead them, they're going to be led by the power of the Holy Spirit of God. Don't give up. Because there's issues in your family. There's division, there's strife. Mend it. Mend it. Fix it. There's nothing more special to your life than your own family. A lot of times we don't realize that until we don't have them anymore. Later on, don't live a life of shoulda, coulda, woulda. Take care of it now. Make sure there's a bond. Make sure the family knows that you're someone they're back on. Be there for one another. And like Billy said, straight up, have communication. Understand one another. Be just like a friend that you can deal about everything and anything. And our kids don't have to go anywhere else to find answers. Because the answers in the house are. God bless you and I with our children. And give us a responsibility to lead them to a higher ground. That's our job. God gave us that. Responsibility. Fulfill it. Teach your kids the way of the Lord. Solomon said, when they get old, they will not depart from it. Plant the seed of the gospel, the power of the Word of God, the companionship you find in Jesus Christ. And to understand that we're out alone, and the world turns upside down, God will turn it right side up. On his testimony. That's why David said, patiently I waited upon the Lord, and he heard my cry, and delivered me from all my afflictions. everything that was wrong, everything that was hurting, everything that I didn't understand, King David said, God delivered. Did God bring deliverance? Did God bring strength to you? And believe in the power of Jesus Christ. Do not leave this place believing that it's hopeless. Come believing that something good is going to happen. And we need to make that happen. You need to make that happen. Trust the Lord with all your heart. And do not lean on your own understanding. Be led by the power of the Holy Spirit of God. And the leader said today, just take a rest of our time. Don't be never go around, just walk it. One step, one moment at a time. And God has an answer. Patiently, I wait upon the Lord. Heavenly Father, tonight is to love you. To be the Lord, to trust you. It's our responsibility. We're so good about when things are going away and we're blessed. Well, yes, Jesus, we love you. We need to find you, Lord, when our world turns upside down. We need to understand when our heart is broken. You are the mender of hearts. We need to understand that when things just don't make sense, you put things into perspective. Because as your children, your hand is upon our lives to lead us to blessings, to prosperity, to be blessed in life. We all walk through these dark moments in life. But that's why, again, he told us. The scripture says, you're a lamp unto our feet, or you light the path. Let us go to your word. And in that darkness, let us find light. And the light is your word. For after all, it was in that word that you said, call upon me and I'm going to answer. I will show you great and mighty things in your life. And that's what we need. We need confirmation. We need to know, Heavenly Father, it's going to be okay. Lift us up. Lead us. Bless us. Allow us to have the faith to move on to us. To believe in all our hearts. And your Bible, the scripture says, and to all who believe, all things are possible. Don't say never. Let's not say it can't be done. Let us take the mindset and attitude of Paul when he said, I can do all things through Jesus Christ who strengthens me. Thank you, Jesus, for family. That a bond might be set. You know, it seemed like a roaring lion seeking whom it may devour. When a family builds a fortress covered with the blood of Jesus and see why Holy Spirit, there's going to be strength, and there's going to be victory, because in Jesus Christ, my Lord and conquerors. We ask it in the precious name of Jesus Christ. As we all go to our places, I want to ask a favor. Everybody extend your hand in this direction this time. Brother Sean's mother passed away yesterday. May God will bring peace to Sean and his family. God just reveal it all to them, let them know they're not alone. Heavenly Father, in the precious name of Jesus Christ, we speak of life. In this case, we speak of power, Heavenly Father, and for them to understand, as I wrote to him yesterday, and said, she may rest in peace until we get together once again in the rapture. Heavenly Father, we pray for our sister survivors. She's with you. She's in your presence. She's fine. But we ask for Sean and his extended family. Extend your hand of love and mercy. Fill the void for them in their lives. Oh, let the Spirit of Almighty God come over their lives and let them know that your will has been done. Thank you, Jesus, for her life. Thank you for her impact. Thank you for the legacy she left behind. But most important of all, the prayer that family can direct unto you, as we heard in the word today, to speak to you to pray and draw strength. I ask in the precious name of Jesus Christ. If you need a tiny envelope, at the usher. It's the end of the month. This is it, people. May is done. We're heading into the summer months. And I'm really, really happy this morning because I expect a lot less people. I already took off on the Memorial Weekend. Yeah, but it's good to see you. And you're in the house of worship. We pray that what you receive that you would hopefully as you go forward in your Christian walk. There's a lot of things for to come. We have a lot of events coming up in the very near future that I'll make you aware of. So listen like you do. This afternoon at 6 o'clock. We need help for all the people who want to come back and help us. We're going to start sorting out all of the stuff for the sidewalk sale we're going to have on next Saturday. We're coming in here this afternoon at 6 o'clock and start sorting things out. Start getting everything ready. The last day you can bring, contribute something to that sidewalk sale is going to be on Wednesday. On Wednesday will be the last time. And of course, Saturday morning, we're going to need volunteers like at 6 in the morning to come help us. Take all the tables out. A few that can kind of lend us your shades. I mean, not your shades, but shades. It'll be out. It's going to be a little bit hot out there. So we didn't need you to be part of what's going on. The money being raised by this sidewalk city is for the worship of the stars we're going to have this coming summer, August 5, 6, and 7. And I just want you to know also in your calendars, kind of mark this date off. July 13th, 14th, and 15th is going to be VBS, Vacation Bible School for the Kids. So put that into your calendar, 13th, 14th, and 15th. We're working on a brand new website. It's going to be awesome. A new website that they're putting together. And in there, we'll have a calendar. You're going to be able to go to, and everything that's official of the church is going to be there. All right, we can't put in everybody's birthday parties or stuff like that, but we're talking about church events that we can deal with. And God has blessed me with people, so many people are going to help me do what God's called me to do. You know, and as time goes on, it's like everything. Everything has transitions, has movements going forward. But always in the cause of Jesus Christ, it's always going forward. Going forward. Don't look back, just go forward, because all the blessings are still ahead of us. So in order to really initiate this just a little bit better, make it a little bit stronger. So there was here Wednesday night, we revealed the new church logo. It officially marked the big drive down. We got to raise that money for that August thing. And we have it here somewhere. Oh, here it is. And this is going to be the new church logo. So everywhere you see this, you know who it is. You would exactly say, that's my church. We're going to thank God for what he's doing. And I'm going to Because I pray to instill into your minds and hearts, he said, the best is yet to come.
Amen.
I really believe that God is getting ready to pour out of his spirit on the church. But there are certain steps that we have to take. Number one is the body to come together. Both the Spanish and English congregation. Understand there's only one Jesus, one church, and we go together to battle knowing that in Christ we are more than conquerors. I cherish your prayers. If you need me, I'll get up. I'll get up and go. You know. Because I know I still got some time. And God has been good to me, and like I said, thank you for the ones that have taken the time to call. And maybe sometimes you called and I was asleep. I've been doing a lot of sleep. I guess I needed that. But people, literally, it's just for a moment. We'll get this thing. We'll beat this thing. So a couple more weeks of getting people to help me preach. And then we'll get back on our feet and get this thing done. Thank you, thank you, thank you for your love. I love all of you. Now let's stand up and give God our tithes and offerings of obedience. Because God says he's going to bless her, she'll forgive us. Nini, thank you very much for the word. Thank you. Heavenly Father, to be able to invest into your kingdom, that's our responsibility. Because you bless us in such a special way. We pray, Lord, that today as we bring our tithes and offerings, we'll bless everyone, Lord, that makes an investment to your kingdom. Let their money be multiplied. Let the blessed Almighty God be upon them. And the ones that can't do it, just bless them, Lord, so they can in turn, in the future, help us, Lord, to care for the gospel of Jesus Christ. For we ask in the precious name of Jesus. Amen.